Welcome. So this is chapter 9 in Mishkin's money and banking textbook. So here we're going to be looking at financial crises, which is obviously really relevant for a variety of reasons. We suffered through a financial crisis recently, and so it's become a lot more important in terms of thinking about the role of monetary policy and broader economic policy. So one of the things that, one of the obvious questions that we're going to look at, of course, is what causes financial crisis, and in particular, what are the, some of the sources or reasons for why we get into financial crises to begin with. We'll discuss some of the symptoms, and more generally, what financial crises look like and how they behave. And in addition to this, we'll also take a closer look at why financial crises can be so debilitating, because at the end of the day, financial crises, if they're simply isolated to the financial markets, if they have no broader impacts on the real economy in terms of production, employment, incomes, et cetera, then it might not necessarily be a big deal. But it turns out that there's a lot of reasons for why those things would be linked. So in order to understand the genesis of financial crisis, it's important to understand the role that asymmetric information plays. So the basic fundamental issue here is that with a healthy functioning financial system, typically that's characterized by low asymmetric information. Now what we mean about that is that asymmetric information really represents trust in financial markets. So it ultimately the idea of asymmetric information is such that so parties to a particular transaction don't have complete information about the intentions or motives of others. And so this is a fundamental problem in financial markets in the sense that you can have buyers that have incomplete knowledge about the quality of their products, the intentions of sellers, or the ability to be delivered the goods and services that they paid for. And so this is a really a big problem in financial markets, and there's a variety of ways in which financial market participants try to solve this. So there's two types of asymmetric information. The first is what's referred to as adverse selection. So the idea here is simply that this is information problems that occur before a transaction happens. So the classic example of this is the people who are most likely to want to borrow money are also the ones that are coming to the bank to borrow those money. Okay, so the potential bad credit risks in this case, those are going to be the first ones that line up at the bank to borrow money, right? Because people who already have money, who are good credit risks, don't necessarily need to borrow money to begin with. So you already set up a situation in which this adverse selection process means that bad credit risks are going to be the ones borrowing money, and that can cause issues. And then the second piece of the puzzle is moral hazard. In this case, this is just a situation where you have information problems occurring after the transaction occurs. And so we can think about this in the example of a lender and a borrower in the sense that with moral hazard, the lender can't perfectly monitor the activities of the person that's borrowing the money. And so because the borrower could be desperate, they're borrowing the money in the first place, so there's reasons why they need the money, right? In this case, they could pursue risky activities to try to get a high risk but high reward outcome. And so because of that, the borrowers, through this moral hazard-ish situation, are more likely to engage in more risky activities, which the lender doesn't want to see because they want to get paid at the end of the day. And so it turns out that during financial panics and crises, these asymmetric information problems heighten, and they sharpen dramatically, in fact. And so the basic idea here, then, is that if these asymmetric information problems occur, then borrowers don't know much about lenders, lenders can't really know much about borrowers or find them, and so as a result of this, lending often dries up. And this reflects this notion of financial frictions in financial markets. And so in this case, when we have financial frictions, you have capital allocated very inefficiently, and a result of this or a symptom of these financial frictions is that you see credit spreads rise. So the difference between market interest rates and so-called safe interest rates becomes much more dramatic. And as a result of this, you can see things like banks and financial firms, they stop lending or they significantly slow their lending. And as a result, economic activity contracts sharply. So there's two ways we can look at that. We can look at financial crises in advanced economies and emerging market economies. I'll talk very briefly about emerging market economies at the end, but we'll focus mostly on advanced economies and the structure of financial crises in these economies. There's three basic stages. The first is initiation of the crisis, so in other words, what triggers the crisis. The second stage is that trigger eventually leads into a banking crisis where you have bank and financial market failure. And it could be the case, not always, but it could be the case that could lead to a third stage, which is referred to as the debt deflation stage. And so in essence, you have falling prices, and that increases the real debt burden on households and firms, which leads to further contraction. This is a schematic of what these three stages look like, and so I'm going to talk through each of these stages just briefly, and so we'll go through these one by one. In terms of triggers or initiation of financial crises, the first step, there's several ways in which this can get the ball rolling. So, for instance, we can have mismanagement of financial innovations or liberalization. So there's a few basic notions of this. So first of all, you could have the introduction of new financial products or methods in the financial crisis of 2008. People looked at securitization and mortgage-backed securities and a lot of fancy derivative products that led to this financial crisis. You could also have changes in regulations or supervision of financial markets and firms. So deregulation in particular, lack of supervision, that can also lead to this as well. We could have innovations or liberalization, in this case, can lead to a credit boom, and that's exactly what we saw during the most recent financial crisis. That leads to increases in credit or leverage, often through lending. As a result of this also generally leads to less scrutiny over the lending process and lending standards. And you can also see government safety nets get less. That weakens market discipline. You can see risks heightening and through a reach for yield, and all of this could create problems, which eventually leads to a decline in the quality of loans through this credit boom. The result, of course, is that if the quality of loans decline, then eventually, if problems surface in the broader economy, defaults are going to rise, losses on loans are going to build, and eventually firms are going to reduce their lending to stem the losses on those loans. And so you'll see a process of deleveraging occur where firms stop borrowing, where financial firms stop lending. And as a result of the dry up in lending, these asymmetric information problems worsen and financial frictions rise. Keep in mind, financial firms, those are the ones that solve oftentimes these asymmetric information problems, because the need to lend and the need to find out the intentions of borrowers on both the moral hazard and asymmetric information problems, that leads to this desire to improve asymmetric information. And so if you have less lending going on, less activity in the financial sector, there's going to be less of this asymmetric information problem being solved. And so these problems heighten and the financial frictions rise. As a result of that, you get economic contraction. Another trigger could be asset price booms and busts. So this can be a situation where you have assets, the prices of assets are fundamentally misaligned with the real values or the tangible values or the so-called fundamental values. Stock market bubbles or housing bubbles, these are classic examples. Again, in the most recent financial crisis, we saw the housing market be the sort of trigger for this. And so the basic story is that you have speculation in these assets, which drives the credit boom, and you have a lot of leveraged credit being generated. And eventually, you would see with all asset price booms, you're going to see the bust, so asset prices are going to collapse. And that's where the problem starts. So you have financial firms' assets and their net worth declines. You have the value of collateral declines significantly. So if banks are holding mortgages, for instance, and the value of housing prices plummets, then the value of the loans that they have goes down. So financial firms start deleveraging, they reduce their lending and reduce the debts that they hold, and because of that, they also ramp up tighter lending standards, and all of this leads to a decrease in lending. And as we talked about before, with the decline in lending, with the reduced activity in the financial sector, moral hazard increases, asymmetric information rises, and we also see an increase in financial frictions. And all of this, of course, leads to lower lending, which leads to economic contraction. A third trigger can be increases in uncertainty, and this can occur for a variety of reasons. You can have failure of high-profile firms, and this can trigger panic in banking and financial markets. To give you some examples, we saw in the 2008 crisis, Lehman Brothers, AIG, and a variety of other really large financial firms in the U.S. Fail or come close to failure or need bailing out. And so that is an example of a heightened uncertainty which can trigger panic in financial markets. And so as we've talked about in previous examples, when you have these increases in uncertainty, these increases in financial friction, then that leads to this higher adverse selection and the moral hazard problem. As a result of this, lending dries up, and we end up in the same situation as we've talked about, where we have economic contraction. So the punchline here is that all of these triggers, the three triggers here that we talked about, uncertainty, asset price declines through the boom bust, and these other things, so all of these things feed through to heightening the adverse selection and moral hazard problems. And as a result of that, that leads to contraction in lending and a contraction in economic activity, which leads us into the second stage here, which is the banking crisis. So the basic mechanics of this are such that the banks, they're lending money out, and the economy starts to collapse. And as a result, you have big losses on loans. And that's exactly what we saw in the financial crisis in 2008 and 2009. So you see a deterioration in the balance sheets of financial firms and banks. Some financial firms become insolvent, which means they can't pay off their current debts, and so they have negative net worth. And at that point, then you start to see banks failing. And when banks fail, that becomes very problematic for the broader banking and financial system, because then you start to have bank panics. You have people running to the bank, pulling out their funds out of banks, and that can accelerate very rapidly. So you see bank runs by depositors. On the bank side, you see fire sales by banks. So banks are holding assets, and because nobody wants to touch any of the assets that are tied to this downturn, you see fire sales, which means essentially that banks would be willing to accept anything that has a positive value for the loan portfolios that they have. So they take really big losses in order to unload these assets, which otherwise might have tangible value. In addition to that, you are likely to see larger, what's referred to as haircuts on collateral. So if banks or financial firms at this point are trying to access credit markets, then you have to put up collateral. And so this collateral could take the form of, say, commercial paper or U.S. treasuries or something like that. Well, in terms of more risky assets, they're going to have to take a haircut, which means they're going to the collateral value of that is going to be worth less and less relative to the market value, simply to account for the risk. So as a result of the bank panics and all of this process, you see banks fail. Because there's less banks operating, again, there's less ability for the financial sector to solve these asymmetric information problems. So we have greater asymmetric information, heightened financial frictions, and we see a further contraction in lending. And that, of course, as we talked about before, when lending goes down, investment, consumption, and broader economic activity goes down. And so that sort of sums up the second stage. And so at this point, the economy reaches a fork in the road. It can either sort of muddle along and eventually get better. And this typically happens through government intervention, heavy government intervention, and perhaps with the cooperation of private entities. You have stabilization in the economy occurring, uncertainty declines over this period, and this typically would lead to a slow recovery and to the point where the financial crisis eventually subsides and ends. An alternative path would be that you have weakness and instability persisting. And the basic idea for this is this leads us into the third stage, in which you have this weakness. It erodes confidence in the economy. It provides a downward draft on prices, and that provides this debt deflation stage that we'll look at here. So as I said, we're at this fork in the road where we can either have out of stage two a really slow recovery, or if things are really bad, then prices continue to fall, and that leads us into this debt deflation stage of stage three. So in terms of stage three, the story is pretty simple, that, again, you have these sharp economic contractions occur, you have persistent weakness in the economy, and this leads to a wholesale decline in the price level. And so this might in and of itself seem great, because if prices are falling, that means things are cheaper. So we can buy more things when the price level goes down. Or better yet, why don't we wait to buy things so that we can buy things cheaper tomorrow or in the future? And that represents the fundamental problem of deflationary conditions, is that this actually contributes to more economic weakness on a couple levels. So in general, the idea is that as prices fall, as you get a decline in the price level, this leads to an increase in the real debt burden by both households and by firms. So if your nominal debt is, if your debt is denominated in nominal terms and the price is falling, then the amount of money that you're paying in real terms to service that debt goes up. And so as a result, you're likely to see the net worth of households and firms go down. That can lead to a lot of problems. The net worth of households means they have less collateral, they have less ability to borrow. Same on the firm side, if net worth is going down or negative, they have less access to capital markets and lending markets. And so lending in credit markets goes down, and that again exacerbates this prolonged period of economic contraction and weakness. And so that leaves us here at our third stage, where we have this decline in the price level, these financial frictions rise, and you get these, again, these adverse selection and moral hazard problems worse, go down, lending goes down, and economic activity declines further. Now, we can look at the same problem from an emerging market standpoint. And so there's a lot of parallels or similarities, rather, between emerging market and advanced market countries, but there's also some key distinctions between the two. So, for instance, in terms of the first stage, which is the triggers, the triggers are one is pretty similar in the terms of the financial liberalization aspect of it, but it's a little bit different in the sense that if you're an emerging market country, you can also be exposed to globalization. In particular, you're much more exposed to international capital markets and the impacts and the strong changes in international capital markets. So as we talked about with the financial liberalization on the advanced country side, similarly in emerging market countries, financial liberalization can be a trigger. But oftentimes this is due to poor oversight by governments, simply because they don't have experience in these fancy financial market instruments. And so they get caught in situations where the country just isn't ready to appropriately integrate these types of new financial instruments into the economy. And so both of these can create severe fiscal, both of these can be triggers. The second point is that you can have the severe fiscal imbalances. So again, you can think of governments as running sustained deficits. Again, if these are small emerging market countries with large deficits, that can create real problems. And so in addition to that, that leads to lack of access to international credit markets. You can see sharp increases in interest rates as a result of these severe fiscal imbalances. And all of these can lead to currency crises. And in previous, in chapter 18, rather, there's videos we talk about speculative attacks and how that can impact the economy. But effectively, with these triggers, this leads to the second stage, which is these currency crises. So this can lead to speculative attacks where the central bank either has to defend its peg by drawing down international reserves, or it could end up running out of reserves altogether, in which case you get a sharp devaluation. And so in that case where you get a sharp devaluation, again, you have a mismatch between the domestic value of the debt and the fact that it's denominated in foreign currency terms, and that can create a balance of payments crisis. And then the third stage is a full-blown financial crisis, and then, again, this is, as I talked about before, triggered often by the speculative attack. So the idea here is that if the central bank can't defend its peg, you're going to get this sharp devaluation occur, And because of what's referred to as currency mismatch, the fact that debt in emerging market and developing countries is often denominated in foreign currency terms, when you have this sharp devaluation, the debt burden domestically rises sharply because of that currency mismatch. And so that results in this balance of payments problem. You get a big contraction in lending. You have often high inflation as a result. And you can also get a sharp contraction in economic activity as well. And so that brings us again to a summary here. You can see of these things. You have the triggers up here in these emerging market countries. That often leads to these currency crises where you have the foreign exchange crisis occur through speculative attacks and whatnot. Again, you get these adverse selection problems, asymmetric information problems occurring as a result, typically through the international capital lens, which leads us to the third stage, which is the full-fledged financial and banking crisis part of it. Thank you.